Welcome, church family, to day 18. We are so close. You've been doing good. Don't give up. Look, today we're going to check out how we can continue to expand our prayer life. And we've been doing so by looking at the prayers the apostles prayed in the New Testament. So today we're going to look at a prayer that Paul prays in Romans chapter 15. If you got your Bible, you can turn there now. We're going to read verses 5 to 6. Here's what Paul says. It says, "May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now here, Paul is praying for harmony. He's praying for unity in the church between the people of God. What's interesting is that prior to this prayer, Paul has just finished addressing legitimate differences between the Jewish and Gentile believers there in Rome. That fact alone tells us that the unity Paul is asking God for here is not unanimous agreement on all things. Rather, Paul is wishing for a unity that brings us together and allows us to live in harmony, even with our genuine differences. Now, isn't that something we need today? We really need it today. That's why it's such an important prayer. But that being said, if we're going to expand our prayer life, part of what we must start to do is begin praying regularly for those things that are on God's heart. God cares deeply about what's on your heart, but if we want to expand our prayer life, we must learn to start praying for what is on His heart and praying for the things He desires. We must get beyond our own prayer list and pray for what the Word tells us God wants. And right here with this prayer in Romans 15, Paul's given us a glimpse into what God wants, into His heart. He's indirectly letting us in on part of God's desire to see a unified church moving in harmony with one another. That God actually desires a church that's not swayed by disagreements and differences, rather that we could unite around Jesus and act as one voice and bring praise to God. That's what the Lord desires. And I believe it's part of what's needed for the church to truly become effective and operate as God intended. Now look, I'm not a car guy, okay? I mean, I know nothing about cars. I know enough to maybe change my oil, change my wiper blades, but that's where my knowledge stops. So when I needed my back brakes changed, I reached out to a friend who does know cars. And I asked him if he could help change them. That allowed me to keep some extra money in the budget. Now, I'd never seen my brakes completely disassembled like they were that day. It wasn't even a ton of pieces, but it was more than I wanted to handle or manage. But even with my limited knowledge of cars, I know enough to know that if my friend did not fit those pieces back together perfectly, and those brakes weren't working together in harmony, I was in for a crash. Thankfully, again, my friend who helped, he knew what he was doing, and my brakes are so good, I'm convinced they're gonna work till Jesus comes back. He put them back perfectly, and now they're completely effective because they're working in harmony as intended. In the same way, a church that's divided, a church that's in pieces, or not working together in harmony, will never be effective. In fact, that church might be headed for a crash. Only in unity, only working together in harmony, will the church operate as God intended and become truly effective and fruitful. So, the first application for all of us today, as we expand our prayer lives, is that we begin praying for unity in the church. We take this scripture and we pray it back to God, and we ask Him for what is on His heart. But I want to make a second application for us today. You see, unity in the church doesn't just mean unity here at Northwoods, though that's what we think of first. Remember, Paul wrote the letter of Romans not to one isolated group of Christians. He wrote it to the city of Rome, all the house congregations that were meeting there in that city. And so God desires unity, not just in Northwoods, this one group of believers, but also between believers, all the churches in Peoria, in this city. So as you and I pray for unity, I wonder, are there things that we've said or done that's contributed to division between us and other churches in the area? And if so, what would Jesus want us to do about that? If the Lord brings something to mind, if that resonates with you at all, I want you to take time to wed your prayers and your actions. Pray for the unity that Jesus wants, but then live in such a way that doesn't hinder the unity he wants, but actually helps produce it. Again, friends, it's the united church, the church that is walking in harmony, even in the midst of differences, that will truly become effective and fruitful in the Lord's hands in the days to come. So may God grant us to live in harmony with each other. We'll see you tomorrow. God bless you guys.